In this video, we're going to talk about Newton's law of universal gravitation. This was proposed by Isaac Newton in the late 1600s as he was observing not only an apple falling to the ground, as the story goes, but also looking at stars and planets and the moon and how they move. And he proposed that the same force that causes the apple to fall to the Earth is the same kind of force that keeps a moon orbiting around the Earth. So the law of universal gravitation states that there is a force between any two objects that can be big or small, and this force is called the gravitational force, and it comes in pairs. And notice the two forces are in equal and opposite directions, reminds us of Newton's third law. And also the distance between the masses affects how much force it is, in addition to the mass of the object. So the equation is Fg, gravitational force, is equal to big G, the gravitational constant, times M1 times M2, these are the mass of the two objects, divided by the distance between the two objects squared. And you'll know that there's a capital G, which stands for the gravitational constant. And this was measured in 1798 by Henry Cavendish with a torsion balance. And he measured that this number was 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11 Newton meter squared per kilogram squared. So you might wonder, what is the difference between Newton's law of universal gravitation and Fg equals mg, because they both seem to calculate gravitational force. And the way I like to think about this is that Fg equals mg is like the local kind of version, while the big G M1 M2 over R squared is the more universal version. Fg equals mg works on the surface of the Earth when you know the gravitational field, or another planet that you know the gravitational field. But if you're looking at the gravitational force between any two mass, then you're going to have to use the universal version. Now, you might wonder, why is G 9.8 on Earth? And this is a good opportunity to find out. So if I set up mg equal to big G, and we're going to look at, we're going to use this apple on the Earth example. So the m, the little m, is going to be the apple. Put a little m right here. And then we're going to make the Earth the big M. That's the mass of the Earth. So big M, a little m, divided by R squared. You'll notice the M's will cancel out. And we get that G is equal to big G times big M, which is the Earth's mass, divided by R squared. If we plug in the Earth, let me go ahead and just write Earth here so we'll remember that. If we plug in the Earth's mass and the radius of the Earth, we're going to get 9.8 newtons per kilogram. And so this 9.8, the reason it's 9.8 has to do with the Earth's mass and the radius of the Earth. Now notice the R on the bottom here. So the R is the radius of the Earth, but really it's the distance between the center of the Earth to the center of the apple. Imagine that the apple was to go higher and higher up into space. It's going to start to affect this G number, and as R gets bigger, then the G will get smaller. And we can represent this with something called a gravitational field line. So if this is the Earth, and these are gravitational field lines, I'm going to draw a few of these right here. And the distance between how close or how far away the lines are represents the gravitational field. So you'll see that over here it's very close. So I'll put a big G. As you get further away, the lines are getting further away. So we have a smaller gravitational field. So this is just a way to represent the gravitational field and how it's affected by the location, how far away you are from the planet. Now we'll solve some problems using Newton's law of universal gravitation. Two objects with masses 5 kilogram and 10 kilogram are separated by a distance of 2 meters. Calculate the gravitational force between them. So I have M1 and M2, and the distance is going to be measured from the center to center. Here's our equation, Fg equals big G M1, M2 divided by R squared, and big G is 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11. And this number doesn't change. It's, as far as we know, it's the same anywhere in the universe. Mass of object 1 times the mass of object 2 divided by the distance squared, which is 2 squared. And we get 8.34 times 10 to the negative 10 newtons. Now we're going to take a look at problem 2. The mass of the Earth is 5.97 times 10 to the 24th kilograms, and its radius 6.37 times 10 to the 6 meters. Calculate the gravitational force acting on a 70 kilogram person at the Earth's surface. So we're going to start this with using kind of the old-fashioned way, Fg equals mg, just to calculate, see what we get here. And m is 70 kilograms, g is 9.81. If we multiply that, we get 687 newtons. All right, so that's kind of the old-fashioned way of calculating gravitational force. And now we're going to use our kind of the universal version of it. Big G times M1 times M2 divided by R squared. Okay, so we're gonna multiply the mass of the two objects, the person and the Earth, divided by the distance between the two times the gravitational constant. Big G is 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11, and that doesn't change. It's the same anywhere in the universe as far as we know. M1 is the person, 70 kilogram, and now the Earth's mass, which is 5.97 times 10 to the 24th. Divided by the distance between these two masses, which is 6.37 times 10 to the 6th meters, and that needs to be squared. And when we can't calculate all that, we end up with 687 newtons. So the same answer that we got using F equals mg. So a good question is, why do we use this method? Well, if you know the g, so you need to know the gravitational field strength, then you can use Fg equals mg. But the problem is, if you are on a different planet and you don't know what low G is, or maybe you're not even looking at something on a planet. Maybe you're just looking at two objects, a bowling ball and another bowling ball. What's the gravitational force between two bowling balls? Well, then in that case, you can't use Fg equals mg. You're going to have to use a universal version of the equation. All right, so now let's take a look at problem 3. A satellite orbits the Earth at an altitude of 3 times 10 to the 6 meters. The mass of the Earth is 5.97 times 10 to the 24 kilogram, and the radius of the Earth is 6.37 times 10 to the 6 meters. Find the orbital velocity of the satellite. So in this problem, I'm going to use little m as the mass of the satellite and big M as the mass of the Earth. And we're going to not only use the law of universal gravitation, we're also going to be thinking using the centripetal force equation because we're looking at the orbital velocity. So this is going to take two concepts and bring them together. The centripetal force equation is net centripetal force is equal to mv squared over r. And in this case, what's playing the role of the centripetal force is the gravity force. So big G times m1 times m2. Now m1, I'm going to make that the mass of the Earth, and m2 will be the mass of the satellite divided by r squared, equal to mv squared over r. Now you'll notice some variables that will cancel out. One of the masses will cancel out, and that's the mass going in a circle, not the mass of the planet, but the mass that of the object, the moving mass that's going in a circle. And then also one of the r's radius will cancel out as well, and that leaves us with big G times the mass of the Earth divided by r, this is the distance between the two objects from their center to center, is equal to v squared. And then I can square root both sides, and I get v is equal to the square root of big G times m over r. Now we're going to do some substitution. Now we got to be real careful here with the substitution because we have, first of all, we have big G, which is 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11. And then the mass of the planet, not the moving mass, so the mass of the planet, which is 5.97 times 10 to the 24. And then this r, we got to be real careful because it's not the radius of the Earth. It's the distance from between the two masses measuring from their centers. So it's going to be the radius of the Earth plus the altitude. So we want to be real careful with that. So we have 6.37 7 times 10 to the 6 meters, and plus, and now we need the altitude, which is 3 times 10 to the 6. Okay, so once we multiply, once we calculate all that, we're going to get 6.52 times 10 to the 3rd meters per second, or 6.52 kilometers per second.